satisfy the equation of structure and freedom in a great way while actually capturing a sensation of the mood of the portrait. The first one we're looking at right here is Oscar Kokoschka, an Australian artist. He served in World War I, was wounded on the battlefield, and actually put on a death cart. And if it wasn't for a nurse seeing something about him and checking his vitals, he would have died. Anyhow, Oscar Kokoschka is considered an expressionist, and you can see it in his mark making here, down in the hands, how those hands really evoke a certain type of sensation, especially that right hand there in terms of how those fingers are curled over, like he's grabbing at something, almost his chest. And in the left hand, he is holding that pencil or brush in such a way that it's so delicate, right? And then look at those eyes and his elongated face and how he gets into describing the jacket and the negative space around his head. Also pay attention to these highlights up in here. All these things, he was, all these formal elements, these formal design elements, he's thinking about, right? I know he's thinking about it. It's as if he's a composer and he's thinking about how he's going to utilize the orchestra. It is the same thing, right? So the difference is, well, the difference is this is visual and music's a time-based thing. We don't need to go into that. However, the composer and the artist use marks to convey a sensation. And there is a sensation in this drawing, all right? So what I want you to do when you're getting ready for these, when you're working through these drawings, is to think about how you're describing the subject matter. You don't have to get all the nuances of the surface undulation of the skin in your face, how there's so many different plane shifts. You don't have to do that. He goes in there and he makes these marks in there and he's probably focusing on darker areas, lighter areas, and allowing the mark to be the mark. The second Kokoschka I picked is this portrait here. And I love this because it's so different than the first one. And I think here he's actually tipping his hat to, oh, artists he probably looked at and studied. Like, I'm going to say these words here. Da Vinci and Michelangelo, other artists too that came later. There's just a certain academic approach to this that also has this flair of freedom in here through how he describes the hair, how he describes the eyes and the mouth. He is really paying attention to relationships, but he's allowing his hand to feel those parts of that, the facial features of who he's drawing. The second artist I choose is Kathe Kollowitz. She also is what's known as an expressionist. She is, though, a German expressionist. She was born in Germany. She lived through World Wars I and II. Her sons fought in I for the Germans, and her grandsons fought in II. For the Germans. So she saw a lot of pain and suffering. What I love about Kate is how she's has an economy of mark making. When you look at this charcoal drawing, and it is charcoal, you can see how she's just allowing the side of the charcoal to grab the paper, or the paper to grab the side of the charcoal and create that gradient up in there in the left-hand side of her forehead, which is really, really beautiful. You can see the mark making back and through here, how she doesn't get into super detail on the left side of her face in terms of hair and whatnot. It becomes more a design element of a darker, I'd call that half moon shape. There's a nice blend between texture, value, and linear qualities. You can see over in here the three different line qualities right in here. Actually, there's more. Look at that sharp one and how it leads into that softer one. She is seeing that and responding to that. And it's immediate. These are things that we should have come out through your, what do you call it, in the gesture drawing. The second Kollowitz is this one. And I love this drawing. I love this drawing for a lot of reasons, because look at how those hands cradle that child's face and head. It is like an amazing sensitive drawing. And there's also tons of freedom in here in terms of how she's describing the shirt sleeve up in here, how the hand comes out of the wrist and arm that comes out of the shirt sleeve, right? And she doesn't get crazy about what's describing up in there. She's got a few marks to describe it and say, this is what it is. You get a sense over in here in this mark of there's the knee, and then she's moving on over in here, a little bit of shadows. And because the emphasis is in the hands and the face of the child, right? That is a beautiful, delicate drawing in there. But it's also really clearly stated, and I do believe it has a forceful visual punch behind it. And you guys know I don't like to use that word punch, but it's got a visual, like, impact, all right, behind this drawing. The third artist I chose to look at is Leonard Baskin, to share with you, actually, guys. Now, Leonard Baskin, American artist, he actually spoke at my commencement from Portland School of Art in 1984, and I actually met him at Vermont Studio Colony in the summer of 84, and I remember having some fun conversations with him and learning about his drawings and really getting into them, because he totally presents portraiture in many different ways, and there's five in here that I want to share with you. So the first one is this portrait, and it's got some beautiful line qualities in it, sharp marks. Let's zoom in here a little bit. Yep. So look at how he deals with that beard down in there. Now, also, I got to be really honest with you about this. These are etchings, and so etchings is a different form of creating visual image. And what you do is you have a zinc plate, you cover it with an acid-resistant layer, you use a nail type of tool to scrape, cut away, or pull away the acid-resistant, and it opens up these like lighter marks in here. Then you drop it in an acid bath, and the acid eats away at it, and it forms like a V-channel shape in the zinc, which you force ink into, then you wipe the plate clean and you put it through a press. And the paper grabs the ink and it transfers from the V shape depression onto the paper. So it is a really still a drawing oriented process. And I love it because of the rich blacks you can get up in here and the white whites you get when you clean that plate really well. Also, look at these sharp lines up in here in relationship to all the texture throughout the facial features, right? Look at that ear. That ear is beautiful. And the highlight on the outside of the ear, right? All right, so there's an etching. Let's call it a drawing by Baskin. There's the first one. Here's another etching. This is actually more of an aqua tint, which you spray a acid-resistant material onto the plate, and then you dip it in the acid, and so you get these light gray areas, because it's more like, think about wherever the speckles of paint or the acid-resistant sits on the surface, the acid won't eat away at it. So you get these beautiful gradients in here, right? And now he probably went back and put an acid-resistant surface on here and then made all these little dot marks and then went back in and put the plate in acid again to create those areas, even with the line in here that's there. So, but what's really you get in here is some beautiful interaction between lines and overall values, or soft textural values. Formally, this is really beautiful in terms of the light in here over on the left, how it curls in next to the light neck, and then how it catches the nose, the bridge of the nose into the forehead, and everything on the left-hand side of the paper is really dark, as if that face is coming out of it. I love this one. Custard. When I saw this last night picking these slides, I was like, oh my God, I love it. I love it because of how Custard comes out, his face comes out underneath the brim of that hat, and how dark it is, and then how you have some light these lines in here and just describing his jacket. Formally, I love these, what's happening in here, how he has these big light areas, right? And then these dark lines and then the dark big shape and how the face comes out of it. And look at what's happening with lines. I mean, the eyes. You guys, I'd love for you to try something like this with your drawing, all right? Let's go to the next one. Oh, we'll go here. Now, this is totally whacked. I love it because I was like, are you kidding me? So down in here, I just want to share this with you. Down in here, there's these numbers that say 123 over 175. So when he made this, looks like a woodblock, actually, to tell you the truth. Whatever it is, woodblock, etching. The 123 over 175 means he ran an edition of 175 prints, and this is the 123rd of that edition. So theoretically, the whole edition from 1 to 175, all those prints should look alike, theoretically. But plates wear down, blocks wear down, and ink is distributed into the grooves or on top of the wood block unevenly through the series. So you get little different things. After that, look at what he does with the formal elements here. These horizontal lines going through there, then the hair of the chin, beard, the nose, the eyes. What happens with the halo around the top of the head down into the right shoulder and arm? That is a whacked image. I love it. All right, the last person we're going to look at is Pablo Picasso, two drawings by him. And this is Francois Jalot, who lived with him the longest. And he did this drawing of her when they were married. And I just love how when you see a picture of her at this age, you're like, yep, he nailed it. That's her. You might call them almond-shaped eyes, but I'm not sure. I love how he creates the facial features in here, coming down the bridge of the nose into the tip of the nose, the mouth, how the hand cradles the left-hand side of the cheek up to the ear, and then how he just puts that hand in there, and he's like, yep, that's the hand, bear it is, boom. Now, I think the real fun in this drawing is how he describes the hair up in here. And then look at this, the dark areas here, coming in here. And so there's a real light, fluffy kind of sensation going on through the hair. Also, the wavy things, like it's water churning up in a certain way, but it's light and airy in there. And I think the darks around the face may help the face to pop out more. And then look at that, once again, the sleeve on the her shirt or whatnot, bam, quick marks, bam, there it is. That's all I want to do. Because the concentration is here in the facial features and the freedom and moving around, though there's a structure in here with all these shapes, is out here in the hair. The last one we'll look at is this Picasso, right? And when I hit this, I was like, yep, totally Picasso. And early on in his career, I think. More like maybe out of the rose or pink period, even though it's a drawing. That's the sensations I get from it. And I think that what's really beautiful about this drawing is the different mark making he's got going, like what happens in the hair, the ear, over here to the right-hand shoulder and collar of her jacket or whatever's happening here, necklace, sweater, shirt, not sure. And then how soft and delicate he is through the cheek, the lips, the nose, and a negative space back in here. And then the eye looking up on the diagonal. So you got 11 images to look at here and to think about. I'm going to drop in folders. Obviously, there's folders up in there with more images in it. And I think you have tons to look at. And what I'm looking for is for you guys to look and go like, yeah, Chuck, I like how this person uses formal elements to describe the portrait or the person they're talking about. And I want to get into it. Once again, guys, this is our last set of drawings you're going to do before the final. So I'm really looking for you to make statements in these drawings, like use those formal elements. Don't be afraid about getting into moving those marks around and exploring. If you have to get into a drawing like this Kokoschka from the beginning, then get into it and really allow those marks to be free in there. Like, you really want to get it right away, and you're going to, there's this urgency of the drawing. If you need to get into, like something more like Baskin custard, then get into it and see what happens, guys. All right, this is our last drawings before the finals once again, and I want you to go into the finals feeling like, yeah, I am going to like have fun with mark making and activating the surface of the drawing page. All right, we'll talk to you soon, and I hope everybody's doing great. Bye.